Hi, this is Dr. Will Wheat, and I am inviting you to watch this next video. It is from our Saturday service, May 6, 2017. We are doing services in my home on Saturday at 10:30 in Chino, California. We are attempting to launch a church here. In fact, we launched a church and we started services at 10:30 on Saturdays. If you're interested in attending one of our services, please call our church office, area code 323-565-2600, and give your name and let us know that you're interested in coming. And we want to do this because we only have so many seats that are available. If the demand or the requests are higher than the seats that are available, we have to rent a larger facility to house everyone who wants to come. And at that time, when you make your reservations to come on Saturday, we will give you the address where we're meeting. Because we're fluctuating from my house to a meeting center, we don't give the address on this video because we don't know which place we're going to be, and that is determined by the number of people that's coming. Also, we meet on Sundays at 1:15 in Los Angeles. The address is 3220 West 85th Street in the city of Inglewood. You can also download our Sunday and Wednesday messages from our website. And our website is www.nccfc.net. So those are the venues that you can contact us, and we're looking to hear from you. Now remember, if you want to attend the Saturday service in Chino, you're welcome, you and your guest. We just need you to call the church office to let us know that you're interested in coming. Then we would give you the address. One more time, the telephone number is 323-565-2600. And with this, enjoy this lesson. It is entitled Identity Part 2. I am sure you will receive a blessing from the message. And also remember that God has plans for your life. And none of those plans. So last week in dealing with audio, with the identity theft, we talked about we all are aware of identity being stolen because either it's happened to us or it's happened to someone we know. So we shared this. Many people have been victimized because of identity theft. As a result, banks, internet businesses have elaborate security measures to protect customers' identities. There is even a more insidious form of identity theft that has hijacked far more than your credit card account. This theft has caused you to forget who you are and believe that you are small, limited, and powerless. A denial of your true self and an assertion of a false you. Okay? So this is what we've been talking about, and how not having your proper identity causes you to live a life far beneath God's intention for you. Okay? Including the noise on the inside, the airport. It's testing today, so you're going to have some airplanes. And I thought they would do this after I finished my Bible study. But we started right on time together, okay? So let's not pay attention to that. So grand theft identity began soon after you arrived on Earth. Parents, teachers, siblings, clergy, and authority figures told you that you are inept, insignificant, ugly, stupid, unworthy, and sinful. And that the world is a dangerous jungle with threats at every turn. Over time, you began to believe these terrible lies until the day came when you forgot your innate beauty, strength, innocence, and safety. So the identity theft has been solidified by our parents, our clergy, different people, school teachers, all buy into this lie, and it's a world hypnotism, it's a world global insanity that's going on. No matter what language you talk about, no matter what country you come from, you do not shall know your true self. Okay? So now, the course that we have you taking, the course of miracles, the course in miracles, not course of miracles, one of the course's strengths is to reprogram our thinking with the truth, to help us identify who we are. Now, in the workbook, it starts off very gently by having you do daily confessions. Well, there's a momentum to that. The course recognizes the fact that you, where you are, and how not to just abruptly put truth in front of you because you can't accept it. So it gently moves you toward your spiritual awakening, if I can say that, okay? Now, Dr. Helen Schuffner received the course as her testimony from Jesus. There was a visitation that she had from Jesus, and he dictated. She became his scribe on writing the course. What makes this interesting, at this time, she's a psychotherapist. She is a professor at a very significant university. She has her own practice. She's Jewish, and she's also considered herself as an atheist or agnostic, if not both. She didn't believe in no higher power. She believed in the fact that you are, you know, just you. Ain't nobody else up there. You ain't going no place but to the grave. She had none of that. She had no Christian teaching upbringing. She never crossed a church threshold. She didn't even go to her own synagogue. So she just was very surprised. In fact, she thought she was losing her mind when the person introduced himself as Jesus Christ. So she went to a therapist to see if she was going crazy, and took tests. She was traumatized, not traumatized, but it really made her aware. And I'm getting these visitations every day. So the therapist says, write down what the voice of Jesus is talking to you about. And that's how she started writing. It took 2 years. And between 2 years of listening to Jesus give her a dictation on what he, where his idea of where all humanity was, about how to restore identity, giving her all the instructions, the editing, that's how we have a course in miracles. Okay? Now, this is over 30 years old. It's over 3 million people have taken the course, but it's just now getting around to us. I always say we're always the last one to get some stuff. But this really intrigued me, and how I don't even know how it came across. I cannot tell you the date or the time that I came across this book. All I know is I came across the book because I was asking questions. I was saying, God, I'm ready for more enlightenment. I'm ready for us to move into an area where miracles is a daily thing. How do we get there? All right, and this is how I came upon the book. Now, the Spirit of God has been dealing with me for the last 30 years, at least since the time I've been pastoring the church, it's 27 years, almost 30 years, on the same line of spiritual growth. So there's not really nothing different. If you've been with me all the time, my pastor, I'm not really teaching nothing really different. I'm just expanding it. We're just going to a deeper insight about spiritual maturity. Okay. Now, I question some of the prayers that we pray as Christians. I question some of the messages we preach as Christians, because we do not preach faith. The underlying current of our messages is doubt and unbelief. The underlying current. Jesus Christ is God, manifest in the flesh. We all agree with that. We say that the cross was victorious. That's what we say. But then we turn around and teach something that we must do to obtain salvation. When we first said that Jesus has saved the world. So if Jesus has saved the world, then there's nothing that we must do to obtain salvation, seeing that it's already been done. Okay? But if you're taught that something is wrong with you, and the first teaching, and you don't even have to be in church to know this, the first teaching that comes out of the Christian church is that you are a sinner born in sin. That's the very first teaching that comes out of the church. You wake up, you don't know nothing. You didn't have to go to church. I'm a sinner. So if your identity, so that's the identity I'm attacking, by the way. So if the identity is I'm a sinner, then it's natural for you to sin, and it's unnatural for you to be righteous or holy. See, to be righteous or holy, you have to work it. But if you're working it and you're acting out righteousness and holiness, then you're doing just that. You're acting. And you're thinking that your natural flow is sin, but you don't act as a sinner. You just sin. That's your nature. You know, so if it's like a dog will bark, that's his nature. So if you're sinning is your nature. So you ain't got to work yet. Because you've been brought into the fact that you are a sinner. So, because you've been brought into the fact that you are a sinner, you accept all things that come to sinners. Sickness, poverty, craziness, disease. Because I'm a sinner, and I don't have it right yet, so I have all these elements that are creeping in on me because I'm not exactly holy enough. I'm not exactly righteous enough. Amen. So you just buy into all this stuff. And you pray to God. You pray, deliver me, deliver me, deliver me. All right? Now here's God looking at you as delivered. You're already delivered. That's how he see you. He see the cross finished. So if you're praying to God, deliver me, deliver me, deliver me, how can he answer your prayer when he's already done what you're asking for? God is not answering my prayer. He already gave you your deliverance. All you have to do is accept it. See, your own mind. So, and the way that you accept it is through your mentality. I promise you, your whole problem is your mind. It is not your body. It is not society. It is your mind. You get that fixed, you're all right. Because you fear stuff. The doctors tell you, well, what's your history? What is your genetic history? What did your parents have? What did they die of? Did they have this? Did they have that? If they had high blood pressure, there's a good chance you're going to have high blood pressure. If they died of cancer, breast cancer, especially women, breast cancer. Did anybody in your family have breast cancer or ovarian cancer? There's a good chance you're going to have these types of cancers. Duh! So this is an official. You ain't had no cancer. You just went for a physical. You didn't go to get no information other than I'm okay. You didn't go to write down no family history and then somebody prophesied to you because your family went through this. Well, it's no better in the church because in the church you go and listen to messages talk about generational curses. That's the same crap the doctor's telling you. If you have this generational curse medically, you're gonna have the same medical problem. So you go to church, they say, well, if you have this spiritual generational curse in your family, you're gonna have the same crap in your spiritual life. Excuse my language, but that's what it is. It's crap. Amen. That says and attacks Jesus and the work of the cross. And see, we don't see that. Whenever you claim something as yours, you are attacking Jesus Christ and God by saying they lied. And my body is a testimony that you lied. I have this going on in my body, so you lied. You won't, you know, we're too righteous to say it out loud, but we said in everything we do, we said in all our conversations, when we talk about, oh, honey, you know what's going on with me today? I'm believing God. Like God is withholding something from me. I'm believing God for. Pray. Deliver me, deliver me, deliver me. Then what did Jesus do for you? Nothing? Nothing? Oh, I'll tell you what he did. He wrote your name in the book of life and just left you to deal with the rest on your own. Whoop-dee-doo. Come on now. See, now, I said that when you could be even appalled at how I'm saying it. But that's what it boils down to. We don't believe. You got to believe regardless of what your body says, because this is what you got to do. you got to do this. And I can preach it all I want to. I just hit my mic. I can preach it all I want to, but you got to believe this. You ain't a body. You live in a body. You are not a body. You just live there. You're not a body. And anything that God creates is not temporary. God does not deal in the temporary. He only deals in the eternal. So if this body is temporary, God didn't make it. This body that's temporary is not the creation of God. What God created is your spirit, which is eternal. He only deals in the eternal. There's nothing temporary about God. He's not testing you. That's what James says. God, don't say that God, when you fall into all kinds of diverse temptations, don't say that it's God that tempted you. Because God don't tempt.
Yes, amen.
To give you a temporary body is God tempting you. To give you a body that is sick, that's God tempting you. God does not tempt with evil. I was so glad to hear that. I was like, I'm glad that nobody was home when I heard that. I got to run around this house and acted like McCullough Company, you know, whatever his name is. And home alone. I said, that is great news. God doesn't tempt, he doesn't tempt you with anything. Anything that God does is permanent. So then what you have, your attack against your temporary situation is not to let it move you. You have to get to the point where no matter what comes in your life, good or bad, it's temporary. So I'm not moved by the temporary. So I'm not even going to talk to God about the temporary.
Lord, that's good.
So what I'm going to talk to God is about, I'm temporarily here, so what am I supposed to do in my temporary existence on the planet? Because this is not my inheritance. I don't even love this. I'm beginning to let it go. It's this temporary. And see, when you get there, all fear leaves. And now you get to understand some things. Should I talk about this Holy Spirit?
Yeah.
How people deal with death. Oh, it's so sad. I'm telling you, people are traumatized over people dying. It's a crying shame on how people wail at funerals and have nervous breakdowns and have emotional they're upset emotionally because somebody died. That's insane. That's absolutely insane. They're not the body. See, you don't believe that you're not a body. They're not a body. They're spirit. Spirits don't die. They are either they finish their work or their life was stolen from them. But either way, they are now awake to look directly in the face of God. The Bible is clear. To be absent from the body is to be present. It's clear. I don't know if y'all believe that, but I do. To be absent from the body is to be present. How can I be sad because somebody's looking at Jesus? In the face. Face to face. It's no longer I believe in Jesus. There you are. I see you. Yeah, you enough. Amen. Sickness is gone. All temporary is gone. Time is gone. They're now in God's bliss or brilliance. They're conscious of it. And I'm telling you, ain't nobody get there want to come back here. So don't be turning around talking about, please come back. Please, quit tripping. Y'all come here. I ain't coming back down there until we get this thing right. Are y'all learning that? See, all this complaining and backbiting and being mad and angry, that's human. That is not God. God doesn't trip like that. And what we try to do is make God us instead of us becoming God. God don't trip. So today's word is the word forgiveness. All of us, including me, got to work on forgiveness. Forgiveness is your strength.
Amen.
See, when you don't forgive, you operate in your weakness. You know, if you hold a grudge, you're operating in your weakness. Amen? So if you're operating in a weakness, you're going to have weakness manifest in your body. When you forgive, you operate in Christ's strength. Amen? So when you forgive, I'm talking about everybody. Everybody, everything, then you begin to see yourself proper. Then when you forgive everybody and everything, then you forgive yourself. Amen. You forgive yourself. And so many of us don't forgive ourselves. And when you're mad at yourself, you're mad at God, your creator. He created you. He's like, why are you creating me like this? Why did you create me tall? Or why did you create me, you know, short? How come I got to be skinny? You know what I'm saying? How come I got to be black? Why can't I come be white? Why come I got to be black? How come my complexion couldn't be lighter? Why can't my complexion be darker? Why is my nose so wide? Why come I can't have a narrow nose? Why do I have big lips? How come I can't have thin lips? Why do I have thin lips? Why can't I have big lips? I'm going to go get an injection to get big lips because I'm tired of having thin lips. People, all this complaining, and they're blaming that on God. News bulletin, you created your body. In eternity, you wanted to know, what did it feel like to be separate from all this glory? What does it feel like not to know God, not to be always in his existence? Father, what does it feel like? If I was in time, which is our creation, I would come as a black man. I would be born in 1953 on May the 11th. Amen. And here I am. Here I come. We did that. You're not born by happenstance. I go back to tell you from the beginning, God do not create temporary. Now, the way the Course of Miracles addressed this, the Course of Miracles addressed the fact and says that you're in a dream. And the reason that it goes that way, because it's easy for you to understand. If you have dreams, and I'm a very vivid dream. I had a good one last night. Mm-hmm. You have a very vivid dream. In the dream, you can sense the place that you're in. I dreamt that I was in this cathedral, and there was, not a cathedral, I'm sorry, auditorium, and there was thousands and thousands of people. And I could see the people, and I was preaching. I was doing a pretty good job in my dream. And it was in another city, okay? Now, here's the reality. Now, I'm dreaming, but I'm in my bed. But in my dream, I'm in another city. All right? Before thousands of people. All right? Now, while I'm dreaming, the only person I'm next to is one wife. But in my dream, and it was real, it was vivid. I could feel it. My body was reacting to it, but I was still in one place. So the Course of Miracles said, what you're doing now is you're dreaming, and you're in the presence of God. Paul's way of attacking this was, he says, set your mind above, where Christ is seated. Now, that's where you're seated. He's letting you know you're not on earth, you're someplace else, and this is a dream. That was his way of doing it. But as the time goes, we learn how to explain it more clearly. You're not stuck to the old way of old intelligence of other people. Your intelligence is a little bit more sharper now. So you can explain it with a little bit more crystal understanding. So, but his way of saying the same thing, all right? Now, Jesus said the same thing that I'm saying to you now. All right, let's go over to Matthew chapter 5, I think. Let me go see where it is. That's not right. Matthew 5:14. Matthew 5:14 says, you are the light of the world. Mm-hmm. You are the light of the world. In my confession, I'm on this. That's my confession today. I'm on the 62nd day of confessing. That's my confession. It says, you are the light of the world. Now, that's my purpose, is to be the light of the world. Jesus said that you are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Your purpose is to be the light of the world. Don't hide your light. Remember the song that we used to sing in the Baptist church? This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, this little light of mine, see? I'm gonna let it shine. So you are the light. You have to let your light shine. That is your purpose, is to let your light shine. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm gonna let my light shine. Yeah, me too. I'm gonna let my light shine. See, that's my, I'm on the 16th second. Yesterday, I am the light of the world. And my confession was, I am the light of the world. That is my only function. That is why I'm here. I'm the light of the world. That's my only function. That is why I'm here. So now you go with the 62. It says, forgiveness is my function as the light of the world. Forgiveness is my function as the light of the world. Forgiveness is my function. I'm the light of the world. I'm going to let it shine. So as a light, what am I going to do? I'm going to forgive. I'm going to forgive. And so long as you're forgiving, you're going to be more like yourself. Amen? Now, if you're unforgiving, then you're in weakness. You lift your jacket.
Yeah.
We moved it.
Okay.
You take the lever and jacket. So now, forgiveness. Everybody say, I am a forgiver.
I am a forgiver.
Say, by being a forgiver.
By being a forgiver.
I am walking in the strength of Christ.
I am walking in the strength of Christ.
Because what does Christ say? He says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. They don't know what they're doing. Forgive them. You know, don't charge this offense to their account. Forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. They don't know that in doing what they're doing, they're hurting themselves. Forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. In essence, to me, that says, don't let that seed they planted come up. Mm-hmm. Because you plant your seeds. You plant your seeds, and whenever you forgive somebody, you're uprooting a seed they planted. Because they don't know what they're doing. If anybody does anything against you, they did it against themselves. Because they can't see them, you, without seeing themselves. See, like, that's one of the things I love about diversity. I get to see all the different sides of me. I get to see all the different sides of me. When I look at you, I see all the different sides of me. And so we can only see each other based on how we see ourselves. I can't see you unless I see myself in you. So if I'm upset with you, I must be upset with myself that's in you. Because if I didn't have that upset in me, I wouldn't see it in you. Yeah. See, you don't never get angry about what's not already in you. Think about it. If somebody does something, either you ignore it, right? You just, you know, especially like if it's a friend or relative, they do something, go, ah, they'll be all right. They'll come back to themselves. And you just go, you just leave them alone. You're like, But if they do something that tick you off, it's in you. It's in you. That's the only reason they got mad. Because it's in them. Because if it's not in them, they don't get mad. Anyway, this is how the scripture says it. It says, to the pure, all things are pure. And the Holy Spirit checked me on that the other day. I was saying, well, to the pure, all things are pure. He says, yeah, well, but that's only part two of that verse. I said, oh? He said, yeah. He said, part one of that verse says, to the evil, all things are evil. And then it says, to the pure, all things are pure. So if you can't find nothing pure, then you the evil. Don't look at nobody. Amen. We ain't got no mirrors up. That's just the information. Don't get upset. That's information. And if that's information so you can be free. See, I'm not evil, so why would I see evil in anybody? Amen. So you should be known as a person that's filled with love and forgiveness. That's how people should know you. They should not be afraid of you. They should not say, man, don't set Tanya off, man. You set Tanya off, woo, Lord, have mercy. It'll be hell to pay. It'll be hell to pay. So you don't want to do that, amen? You don't want to be known for losing your temper. You don't want to be known for that because now you're not acting like the child of God. See, now you are a child of God, so you must be like your Father.
Amen.
The Bible says it this way, your Father is holy, so you be holy. You're holy because your spiritual DNA is holy. Come on, y'all. Amen. See, you ain't got to work, but you ain't got to go take no class on no holiness. You ain't got to hear about no holy message. You're holy innately. It's in you. Now, what's in you from getting out of you? What's stopping what's in you from getting out? All the filters you have in your soul. So the course is designed to pull these filters back. So when you get to your true self, you see that I'm already happy. I'm already filled with joy. I'm already creative. Mm-hmm. You know, all right, I'm already healed. You got to pull all those filters back. Amen? Mm-hmm. See, I'm telling you, all our siblings, our parents, our clergy, been giving us the wrong filters. We got to do what? Forgive them. Come on, yeah.
Amen.
Can't be mad at them.
Yeah.
You got to forgive them. Because if you're mad at them, that's a filter that's not being moved. You got to forgive them. And just say, thank God for today. Thank God for now. My past is gone. Thank God for now. Amen. Amen. The last thing that God put in my heart, I'm going to get back to the slide presentation. The last thing that God put in my heart was that I should share with this, is that you have the mind of Christ. And his mind thinks in your mind constantly. You don't have to wait. His mind is there constantly. Constantly tells you the right thing to do. You don't always listen.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
But you know.
Amen.
All right? You might not listen, but you know. You know what to do. You just choose not to do it.
Amen.
Amen. You know, like, don't you say, God, what should I do? He already told you.
Mm-hmm.
Don't you say, God, what should I do? Because you don't want to do what he just told you to do.
Mm-hmm.
All right? And everything is predicated on forgiveness. So whatever you do, you have to forgive. Don't do nothing without forgiveness. Amen. And forgiveness has to be baptized and anointed with love. Y'all look so excited. I wish I could turn the camera around so you could I get y'all looks and y'all expressions on video. I'm telling you, forgiveness is dipped in love. And that's what God is dipped in love. Amen. You will forgive so well that forgiveness will become unnecessary because you'll no longer have condemnation. Now you understand yourself. God does not condemn because he has no bitterness in him. He's pure love. He doesn't have to forgive because he does not take offense. There's no sin that he pays attention to. Because he sees your original self. He sees what he's created. He sees your eternal you, not your temporary you. Amen.
Amen.
And when you leave the body, you're going back to your temporary you. All right? So let's just jump ahead, and then I'll get a lot of conversation here. I hope y'all learning something.
Absolutely.
Amen.
All right. Now, A Course in Miracles is your friend sitting next to you. Oh, yeah, okay. Now, this is, I need to go back. How many of us ever gone to, he was a baby. When I was in Kerrville, I used to go to the movies every weekend, Kerrville, Texas. And sometimes they were still dealing with black and white movies. And they had the old sound added to the music. You could tell it was fake. And so we'd sit there, especially when we go to see Westerns or cowboy movies. Yeah, I'm looking at you, Robert, and you was there, yeah, maybe Bobby. Amen? We used to go look at those movies. Like yesterday, we were looking at an old King Kong movie. It was so fake. It was so fake. You're in the theater, and you're seeing all this thing, and they're supposed to be scary. It was no way scary. It was fake. And we look at it, man, that is so fake. That is so fake. And so we'd be nudging them, man, that's fake. Don't be scared. What are you scared about? That's fake. I remember the first time The Exorcist came out. We laughed at that. It didn't scare us at all. You know, her spitting up green beans and everybody was and screaming. We just laughed. Everybody else in the cars, we went to a drive and said, everybody else was in the cars just screaming. We were laughing. We thought it was funny because it was so fake. Amen. So, A Course in Miracles is your friend sitting next to you when the monster comes on the screen of the movie of life, he's telling you it is fake. The course elbows you, laughs, reminds you, that's so fake. You can indeed afford to laugh at fear thoughts, remembering that God goes with you wherever you go. No matter how real the effects of the world seem, you have to remember that they are just like those movies and deserve no more credence than the ones you see in theaters. Albert Einstein is said to have noted, reality is an illusion, albeit a persistent one. God did not create a meaningless world. The Course calls us to distinguish between the real world that God created and the illusionary world that fear has manufactured. In the workbook, lesson 14 tells us, God did not create a meaningless world. The lesson asks us to affirm God did not create that disaster, and so it is not real. God did not create that disaster, and so it's not real. Now, I'm telling you, as far as our flesh is concerned, earthquakes, tsunamis, hurricanes, tornadoes are destructive. We can see it on the news. We say that it's real. It feels real, you know, but it's temporary. God didn't create that. God doesn't create disaster. In fact, when you have a disaster in your insurance policy, they call it an act of God. Like God does something to cause disaster, or earthquakes, or something you can think of. Well, that's just an act of God. Now, who wants to serve a nut like that?
Exactly.
My goodness. Somebody just destroy and kill innocent people? Have people starving? One of the things that get me is when people say, how could God let children starve? My question is, how could you? How could you let children starve? How could you not clothe children? How could you not rescue them from cruelty? You looking at it, why don't you do something about it? Why are you waiting on God? He works through people. So he, if he's in you, you should be moved to do something.
Amen.
Okay.
Amen. And praise God. The Course is training us to withdraw the credibility we have attributed to the events that do not spring from truth. Now, wait a minute, the reasoning mind retorts, those events are real. They happen every day. I know people they have happened to. Don't stick your head in the sand of denial and argue that disasters are not real. They are. The Course sees sorrowful experiences from a different viewpoint. It tells us that when we become upset over fearsome events and give them undue power, we are sticking our heads in the sand as we deny the presence of love. This is a radical departure from the way we have been taught to see the world. But if you wish to change your life radically, a radical departure is required. If your life is working perfectly and you are happy, then carry on. If, on the other hand, your current reality is not bringing you the peace you crave, it may be time to consider another way of looking at life. Maybe you need a miracle. Maybe you need an entire course in miracles. Maybe we all do. Great people get real. We also say great spirits, because you are a spirit. Great spirits get real. At first glance, this is an invitation to be honest about who you are, what you believe, and how you want to live. A call to walk. We want our listeners to realize that they are more real than what the world has taught them about themselves. We are each an expression of God, a holy idea breathed into existence. Woo! Just like God breathed in the story of Adam. You're breathed into existence. Wonderful. Amen? We are the divine falling in love with himself. We are the divine falling in love with himself. God loves you.
Amen.
He fought in love with himself because he loved the him that's in you. When you look in the mirror, do you see God in you?
Yes.
But he in love with himself in you.
Is
that right?
Yep.
You are spirit. So you got to love you too.
Yeah.
You got to love the divine that's in you.
Yeah.
All right? We are spiritual beings created in the image of and likeness of the beneficent creator. What he creates is not apart from him. And nowhere does the Father end, the Son begin as something separate from him. So I'm going to end on this one because I want us to stop with this. It says, what he creates is not apart from him. What he creates is not apart from him. What he creates is not apart from him. All right? And nowhere does the Father end, the Son begin as something separate from him. Nowhere does he end and then the Son begin as something separate. You're not separate from God. I'll say it again. You're not separate from God. You're one with him. Now this body, because we can look at each other and we all sit in different chairs, we see separation. But in God's eyes, we're all one. Amen. And there's going to come a time when these bodies are not necessary. Oh, look at that. Amen. That you can live now by faith, by seeing each other as one. Amen. Alright. See, when I see you having an experience for me. Thank God. You know, you meeting people are now that I don't have to meet. But you meet them. But it's for me. And we meet, we are one together. We're having the life experiences. Especially when we start talking to each other about our experiences. You ever notice when we get involved in our experiences and somebody's actually listening to you, but they actually become a part of that conversation with you? They actually feel what you feel? That's why it's not good to criticize people. Because if you criticize people to someone who's feeling that with you, they don't like that person. And when they meet that person, they don't like that person. Now, you done made up with that person. But they don't know about the makeup. They just said, We do that with each other. Are y'all listening? Because we become one with each other. All right? Most of the people who have changed the world for the better are told, get real. Most brilliant agents of positive change have been branded insane, shamed, imprisoned, tortured, and killed. Einstein noted, great spirits have always encountered violent opposition from mediocre minds. Jonathan Swift declared, when a true genius appears, you can know him by this sign, that all the dunces are in a confederacy against him. The Catholic Church kept Galileo under house arrest until his death because he suggested that the earth revolved around the sun.
Wow.
How many of y'all knew that? Y'all knew that? Around the same time, Italian philosopher Giordano Bruno suggested that the universe contains an infinite number of inhabited worlds populated by other intelligent beings. Giordano, or Jared, is like George. Giordano was convicted of heresy and burned at the stake. When the judges issued his death decree, Bruno answered, "Perchance, you who pronounce my sentence are in greater fear than I who received it." Inventor Thomas Edison engaged in a vehement campaign to stop visionary scientist Nikola Tesla from proliferating alternating current AC electricity. Edison wanted the world to depend on his discovery, direct current, and although Tesla's alternating current was far more efficient, Edison would stop at nothing to undermine Tesla including electrocuting horses in public to demonstrate the dangers of the new form of electricity. Wow. Edison was telling Tesla, get real. Tesla had no choice but to answer, I already am. Ultimately, truth prevailed. Now, every time you turn on a light, you can thank Nikola Tesla for getting real. So the next time someone tells you to get real, take the advice as a high compliment. If what you're doing, people don't believe it, you know, you need to get real, just take it as a compliment. If you're thinking about a business, and I want to close with this, as you're thinking about a business, your father is a creator. And one of the things that we're having a challenge with now is jobs. Everybody's looking to work. Everybody's looking for a job. The reality is you may not can find a job because no job can give you the reward that God wants you to have. See, the world has pigeonholed you by your education and your experience, your color, your race, where you live, where you come from, and they won't allow you to break their glass ceiling. They feel because you come to them for work, they have authority to tell you what your work is. And their assessment of your work may not be God's assessment of what you're worth. So naturally, you're frustrated because you're not making or generating enough income to take care of your daily necessities and this dissatisfaction. But there are other people who are totally satisfied. There are other people that you will meet that don't want to do no better. Leave them alone. Don't bother them. Don't mess with them. Don't criticize them. Let them be happy because they think little. And because they think little of themselves, they will be rewarded with little. But you dare to believe in what God puts in your heart, which is always bigger than your experience. God has put something in your heart larger than your experience. Go for it. People going to tell you that's not real, that's not possible. On time.
Yeah.
They're going to tell you, you can't do that, you can't do that. You're not being real. All right? But God put it in your heart. You become unsatisfied in a situation. It's your situation. It's your dissatisfaction. He is saying to you, he's praying to you, let me bless you.
Amen.
And it's time for you to answer God. You want him to answer your prayer. You need to start answering his prayer and let him bless you. Let him create something in you. All right? Give you the identity of the creation and let you receive so that you can be a blessing. He wants to bless you. But if you keep thinking little of yourself, you'll never become the blessing that God intended you to be. He blesses you so that you can bless other people.
Amen.
Amen. Some people might be waiting on you to be yourself. Come on, man. They're waiting on you to answer your call to greatness.
Amen.
So you need to answer your call to greatness. Amen.
People of Greater Los Angeles, Apostle Will Wheat has a word from God that is revealing, powerful, and life-changing. Every Sunday, lives are being transformed by this powerful word from God. Families, businesses, church leaders, and the world are hearing God's plans for their lives. And none of those plans include defeat. It has been said that there have been Jesus sightings in his services. So you owe it to yourself to be a part of one of the greatest movements and Jesus sightings that this city has ever experienced. And you can download Apostle Week's Sunday messages for free at nccfc.net.
nccfc.net.
Sunday services are at 1 p.m. and midweek services are Wednesdays at 7 p.m. There is faith for your destiny at nccfc.
nccfc.net. We'll be right back.